Today I'm going to tell you a little bit about our research on learning with limited supervision. So as you've heard from my colleagues today, it's an exciting time to be working in AI. There's been a lot of progress in many subfields of AI, computer vision. There have been massive performance improvements on a range of key tasks like image recognition, and we now have systems that perform comparably to humans on pretty challenging and difficult benchmarks like ImageNet. Similarly, there's been lots of progress on speech recognition, machine translation, various other NLP tasks. You know, we've been getting good enough that these systems are used by hundreds of millions of people all over the world. As another example, advances in reinforcement learning have enabled computer agents that can beat the very best players at very complex and highly strategic games like Go and chess. And there are three key ingredients behind a lot of these successes. The first one is deep learning, so the use of high capacity deep neural networks, models with lots of parameters that we can use to represent the kind of complex mappings from inputs to outputs that we need in order to perform well in these kind of very difficult tasks. Hardware, GPUs, and parallel hardware that enables us to train these models relatively quickly on commodity hardware. And then the third key ingredient is lots of training data, lots of labeled training data, so lots of examples that we need to provide to the system in order to figure lots of input-output pairs to kind of like show the system what's the right way to solve the task and really take advantage of the fact that these models have a lot of capacity, lots of parameters to fit and in order to perform well in these tasks. So the fact that we need to provide a lot of training data is becoming a major bottleneck whenever we want to apply machine learning to a new domain. And you know, sometimes it's possible to just spend money, collect data, put in the effort and the resources to collect big data sets, and then maybe throw it away when the task changes. But there are a number of applications where getting the data is just not possible. So I work in problems like in the physical sciences where it would be nice to be able to use machine learning systems in that space, but getting the labeled data requires running some really expensive real-world experiments where we just can't afford to run them a million times. Same thing in healthcare. I also think a lot about problems in the applications of AI in the developing world, where again, getting the labels would be extremely expensive. You would have to conduct a survey in some new country, or maybe it's just not possible at all. Right, so what I'll do in this talk is I'll tell you a little bit about the work we've been doing and trying to get around this labeling bottleneck using generative models, so unsupervised learning, semi-supervised learning, and then ideas for kind of like incorporating domain knowledge, like from physics, from common sense knowledge, to try to get around the labeling bottleneck. And I'll tell you a little bit about some of the applications of these ideas in the physical sciences. So the first observation is that although getting labeled data is really expensive, getting access to unlabeled digital data is pretty easy. Sensing, communication, storage is cheap enough that the internet is filled with images, text, videos. And the question is whether it's possible to kind of take advantage of all of this data to learn something about how the world works, learn something about the appearances of objects, about physics, about their relationship. And so really the key problem is how do we build a system that can make sense of these complex, high-dimensional, unstructured sensory inputs in an unsupervised way without actually requiring a lot of interaction, a lot of supervision from a human, so that the system is really scalable and you can apply it easily to enormous amounts of unlabeled data. Right? And so now the key question is, what does it mean to actually make sense of this kind of inputs? And here I like this quote from Richard Feynman. At some point he said, what I cannot create, I do not understand. He was actually referring to mathematical theorems, and he was saying that, well, if he can't prove a theorem by himself, he doesn't really understand it. But I think the analogy holds also in this space. I think if we want to build a model that can really understand this kind of data, like, say, images, then the model should also be able to generate, to create new images that sort of like look realistic, that have the right structure, where the objects have the right appearances, the right relationships. So this is kind of like the idea behind generative models. The idea is that we have a large data set, let's say, of images without labels, and the goal is to come up with a model, a generative model, that we can use to generate new objects, let's say in this case new images, that look like the ones you have in your training set. This, I'm using images as an example, but this can be applied to text, to videos, to other kind of modalities. Now, these are probabilistic generative models in the sense that the model itself is a probability distribution over, let's say, images X. And the model is trained to basically assign high probability to images that look like the one in the training set, like, let's say, natural images. Should assign low probability to things that don't look like natural images, let's say, white noise. And this is a generative model because if we are to set the pixels in the image according to this probability distribution, then we would get objects, in this case images, that look like the one in the training set. So if you were to sample from this probability distribution, you would be able to generate new images that should be realistic, but should not be exactly the ones that you've used to train your model. And in the last few years, there's been a lot of progress in generative modeling. These are some examples of the kind of images that you can generate. This is from a recent paper using state-of-the-art generative models. These images are synthesized by a machine, by a computer. They don't really exist. But as you can see, they're pretty realistic, right? They have the right structure. The objects have the right appearance, the right relationships, the right overall kind of like global statistics, the right smoothness. And so it seems like this model really has understood something about the structure of natural images to be able to produce this kind of results. And indeed, it turns out that sometimes these models are able to recover some of the structure in the data. These models are typically latent variable models, meaning that they try to explain the observed data, in this case, the pixels, let's say, as a function of some unobserved latent variables. Let's say that we're trying to have a data set of images of human faces. Perhaps, you know, we know there is a lot of variability due to gender, eye color, you know, face expression, whether the person is wearing eyeglasses or not. And it turns out that these models basically try to describe the variation that you see in the data as a function of some latent variables. And they are often able to discover this latent structure in an unsupervised way. So even though there's no human telling the model this is a male, this is a female, or this person has eyeglasses or not, they're still able to somehow discover the structure. And then as you can see in the demo on the bottom right, if you kind of like keep all the variables fixed except for one and you change it, you are able to kind of like interpolate in the space and you're able to keep the appearance of the face fixed except for that single attribute that changes as you change the value of this latent variable. So the hope is that because we can discover this latent structure automatically, we can improve performance in other kind of tasks that we care about, like classification or reinforcement learning. And so a natural application of this idea is in the context of semi-supervised learning. So let's say that you have a small amount of labeled data, let's say images and the corresponding labels. Let's say you want to recognize different kind of handwritten digits. And then let's say that you have access to a lot of unlabeled data, a lot of images for which you don't have the corresponding label. So how can we take advantage of the unlabeled data to improve the performance on the labeled, on the small amount of labeled data that you have? Well, we can take advantage of the fact that these latent variable generative models actually discover useful structure in the data. So what we did is we proposed this approach where we can basically combine any latent variable generative model with any discriminative model. Think of this as any classifier that you might want to use for the task. And we couple them together through this shared latent space. So basically, the generative model will try to identify latent structure in the data that is useful for reconstruction, for understanding the distribution that it's trying to model. And at the same time, the discriminative model, the classifier, will try to use these latent features that the generative model discovers to improve its performance. And the key here is that we can train these two pieces together at the same time, no matter what kind of components you use, we can always train them together. And we use this objective, which is a multi-conditional likelihood objective, which is basically an interpolation between a purely generative model and a purely discriminative model, which is what you would do if you were to completely ignore the unlabeled part of the data. And we can train this model using any kind of divergence, KL, or adversarial methods. And it turns out that it works quite well. Just to give you an idea of the results that you can get, let's say on MNIST, with only 100 labels, you can get an error that is less than 1%. On SVHN, which is a harder data set where you have colored images and you're kind of like trying to recognize different house numbers from street view imagery, Again, you can get significant performance improvements using a very small amount of labeled data by using this kind of strategy where you're trying to discover latent structure in the data and use it to guide your classification algorithm. Now, this strategy is quite effective, but then there are cases in which kind of like the model does not discover the latent structure that you'd like it to discover. So it'd be nice if there is a way to kind of bias the model to discover structure that is consistent with our prior knowledge that we might have about a system that we care about. And so one natural source of prior knowledge to kind of like force the model to discover the right things is physics. And so let me give you a simple example of how this might work. Let's say that you're trying to build a model to learn how to track an object moving in a video. There is a red pillow tossed in the air in the video, and let's say that you want to train a model that tries to predict the position of the pillow from the frame, from each frame. So there is a latent variable associated to each frame, which is the height of the pillow, but let's say that you can't afford to pay somebody to put bounding boxes around the object and tell you the height of the pillow. So what can you do? Well, one thing you can do is you can try to exploit your prior knowledge about physics, and we know that the height of the pillow as a function of time will form a parabola, like from elementary physics. So although we don't know exactly what the height is in every frame, we know that the heights of different frames are related to each other through this equation. So what we can do is we can try to train a model to map frames to the height of the pillow in a way that is consistent with physics. So although we don't have any label, we know that if the model is doing the right thing, then the outputs have to be consistent with basically Newton's law. So what we can try to do is we can try to train the system to basically produce outputs that are consistent with each other, that are consistent with physics. And surprisingly, what happens is that this is often enough to learn the right things, or you might need a very small amount of labeled data to actually get good results. So here's an example where in this task of basically tracking objects moving in videos, you can actually get really, really close to ground truth, very close to what you would get if you had a lot of labeled data, purely based on this kind of weak supervision that you provide using your prior knowledge about the invariances, about physical laws. What's interesting here is that if you had to actually pay somebody to provide labels, kind of like the effort and the cost would scale linearly in the number of frames that you have to, that you have to label. While this approach of kind of like providing a high-level invariant, a single equation, scales better in the sense that the same invariant can be applied to as many data points as you want, right? So to the extent that you can find these invariances, this might be a more scalable way to provide supervision to these systems. Now, coming up with the invariances and the equations by hand, in a way we can extend this also to other kinds of forms of prior knowledge, like logical forms, like relationships between objects. And again, we've shown that, I'm not gonna show you the examples in this talk, but you can basically improve the performance by incorporating these kind of constraints that you might have about relationships between objects. So we have the kind of like this declarative language that we can use to specify prior knowledge and provide supervision to the systems. Now, coming up with these formulas is tricky. So another approach that you might wanna use is this idea of using a simulator, right? Perhaps writing the equations is too hard, but you have access to a rough simulator of how this, of how the world works, right? So an example of this, again, in a toy setting, is let's say you wanna learn how to track the position of the pendulum. Let's say that you don't know an explicit equation that characterizes the motion of the pendulum, but let's say that you have access to a simulator. So what we can do is we can do something similar to what we had before. We have the model that is basically trying to map frames into this symbolic space where it's kind of like tracking the position of the pendulum. And we don't have an explicit equation that we can enforce over that space, but we have outputs from our simulator, which we know are consistent with physics. Then we can use an adversarial approach where we basically have a classifier that is trying to distinguish the outputs from our model from the ones provided by the simulator. And if we are consistent with physics, then the classifier should do a poor job at classifying what we produce from what comes out from the simulator. And you can basically train these two components adversarially. You train the generator to try to fool basically the discriminator, like in AGAN. And again, basically, it turns out that this is often sufficient to learn how to solve interesting tasks, like tracking pedestrians in this data set. You can get very close to ground truth with very few labels, and other kinds of tasks, like tracking motion capture. Again, that's another example where using a simple simulator of the human body, you can basically do extremely well at this task of doing motion capture from video. Now, Another situation where using models, simulators, or models of the world is extremely useful is imitation learning. Here the situation is that we have demonstrations provided by an expert on how to solve a task, let's say how to play that video game or how to drive a car on that track. And the goal is to come up with a policy that can produce a behavior that is similar to the training set, to the training data, to the demonstrations that you have in your training set. And so, you know, there's quite a bit of work in this space, but we can think of this also as basically trying to build a generative model, right? We're trying to build a model that can produce behaviors that are similar, that are indistinguishable from the ones that you have in your training set. And it's a very special kind of generative model in the sense that all we have to do is we have to come up with a policy such that when you this policy interacts with the environment, or when it interacts with a simulator of the environment, it produces behaviors, it produces actions and states that are sort of like indistinguishable from the ones that you have in your training set. So we introduced this thing called GALE, which is similar to the approach I showed you before, where we have two components. There is a generator component, which is basically a policy interacting with an environment and producing behaviors, synthetic behaviors. Then there is training data provided by an expert. Then there is, like before, a discriminator that is basically trying to distinguish between synthetic behaviors produced by our model and real data provided by an expert. And then we train these two components adversarially. Basically, the generator tries to produce behaviors that are as close as possible, that fool the discriminator. So, and by doing that, they end up being as close as possible as the training set. And the discriminator is just trying to do as well as it can. Often the discriminator is just another neural network discriminating between these two types of behaviors. And again, this approach works quite well. Here is an example where we're trying to basically learn how to drive this vehicle. And we try to do it, so we're trying to learn what actions to apply in different situations, like braking, steering, accelerating. And we want to do it from raw pixels. So we want to figure out this mapping. And we want to learn this from demonstrations. So we're thinking of this as a generative model. We have some demonstrations of how to drive the car provided by an expert, and we want to learn how to imitate this behavior. And you can see that we are able to do it quite well. The model learns that it needs to move forward, it has to accelerate, it shouldn't bump into other cars, it shouldn't go off the road. And it's doing this by basically from raw visual inputs, so just trying to map the images to the actions by trying to basically imitate the behaviors produced by the in the training set. And what's interesting about this perspective of thinking of imitation learning as a generative model is that we can go back to this idea of trying to discover latent structure in the data, like we were doing before on the images of faces, and we discovered the eyeglasses and the smiling. We can try to do the same thing in this kind of behavioral data. We can try to use these latent variables to kind of understand and try to identify semantically meaningful latent structure in the demonstrations. And again, it turns out that it works, just like before for the smiling and the sunglasses. What happens is that some of the latent variables that we discover using this procedure are actually meaningful. So there is this latent variable where if you set it to 0, then it kind of like corresponds to a preference towards passing on the left. If you set it towards 1, then there is a preference towards passing on the right. And there are other latent variables that capture things like how aggressive the driver is, what kind of preferences it has. So we can think about using these latent variables to kind of characterize different types of behavior, predict the intent of the driver, and figure out, try to understand basically in an unsupervised way, like before, what is the structure in behavioral data, which is exciting because, you know, this works directly on images on pretty high dimensional complex data. And so this is quite interesting because it's easy to collect this kind of data. And if these methods work, then you can really try to understand behavioral data in an unsupervised way. Now, for the final few slides, I want to talk a little bit about how to put all these pieces together. Generative models, incorporating prior knowledge, and in the context of physical sciences. Again, let me start by a simple motivating example. Let's say that we want to design the shape of an object such that when we put this object into a fluid, the object has a small drag coefficient. So it's kind of like the toy version of the problem of designing an airplane, where you want to find the shape such that if you put it into the air, then the drag coefficient is as small as possible. Now, there is a huge space of different shapes that you have to consider, and evaluating how good a shape is can be very expensive. You either have to try it out in the real world, or you might have to run some very expensive numerical simulations, solving Navier-Stokes equations, which can be really, really expensive. And so the naive way of kind of like understanding how this physical system works, which would be to try out all possibilities, is extremely expensive and just not possible in the real world. And so the idea is that perhaps we can try to generate good shapes by kind of taking advantage of these advances that we've seen before in the space of generative models to kind of like identify good latent structure in the data. So instead of trying to directly optimize shapes, what we can do is we can try to set up an optimization problem over this latent, this lower dimensional simplified kind of like representation of the data that is discovered using one of these latent variable models. So instead of directly trying to identify good shapes, we solve our optimization problem over this lower dimensional latent space that is discovered using a generative model. And because it's lower dimensional, it's a lot easier to solve that optimization problem. And empirically, what happens is that you can basically much more quickly identify, in this case, good shapes with a much smaller number of experiments. If you were to work directly over the input, it's so high dimensional that basically doing Bayesian optimization in this case is really, really hard. But if instead of working on that representation, you work on this more abstract representation, a more meaningful representation that you discover this way, then basically it's much more efficient. You can basically get a much better shape in this particular problem with much less, basically, shape evaluation. So you have to do a lot less experiments, either real world or computational. And we've applied these kind of ideas to more real world and more harder problems like designing proteins. Again, this is a difficult optimization problem where you probably don't want to work at the level of sequences of amino acids because that's just not, it's extremely complex and high dimensional space. Instead, what you want to do is you want to optimize over this latent structure that is discovered using one of these latent variable models. This is work in progress, but it's looking promising based on the data collected so far. And so again, we're seeing potential big improvements by using this better representation. And we've looked at a number of other kind of real-world physical problems where collecting data is really, really expensive. Another example is the optimization of LCLS. This is a big free electron laser up at SLAC. It's a huge machine. It's buried underneath 280. It's a really expensive machine, costed a lot of money, and operating the machine costs thousands of dollars per minute. And people spend a lot of time basically tuning these quad poles, these big magnets, to get good performance in the at the beam. And they don't have a good model of how the machine works. They have some simulator that they use to build the machine, but it's not perfect. And so again, basically what we can do here is by using these techniques and combining prior knowledge, data, and kind of like collecting data by running real world experiments in this case, in a clever way, we're able to get much better performance compared to what they were doing before, which is basically manually tuning all these parameters. You can get much faster to better performance. Another example that I'm currently quite excited about is this problem that we're looking into with collaborations in material science on trying to optimize batteries, try to figure out what is the best way to charge a battery very quickly so that you can charge it as quickly as possible. So think of an EV that you want to charge very, very quickly, but you don't want to kill the battery too fast. And so we have this nice closed loop setup where we're basically collecting data on different kinds of charging policies, trying to figure out which ones work and which ones don't. And there's an AI system that basically designs which experiments to do next. And there's an interesting combination of collecting data, simulations, theory, some physics, some invariances. And so we're quite excited about we're getting some very, very interesting new policies and new results in this space. So I think I'm pretty much out of time. So to conclude, I think there is lots of interesting opportunities in this space of kind of combining data with background knowledge, for example, from physics, but also common sense knowledge, combining inductive reasoning with deductive reasoning, And you know, there are interesting opportunities both for developing agents that will perform better in the real world because they know better how things work and they will be much more data efficient. But also, I'm particularly excited about opportunities in the context of the physical sciences, thinking about ways to use AI to speed up the scientific discovery process, figure out how to collect data more effectively, how to come up with new hypotheses, how to come up with new experiments. I think that would require some fundamentally new techniques in terms of modeling and inference. And I think this is going to be quite exciting in the next few years because that's, I think, where it's going to be. AI has maybe not had such a big impact yet, but it probably will in the next few decades or so. And I think I'm out of time, so thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. If you have a poster, please line up and order on the wall, and we'll ask a couple questions. Any questions? They say you should wait 30 seconds, which can get a little awkward. There.
Really excellent talk.
Thanks.
So in the drag coefficient example that you were talking about, what is that latent space? Is it like the radius of that shape, or like what is that representation?
So it's discovered in a data-driven way, so we don't know exactly what it is. We think it's related to basically some Fourier representation of the shape. Empirically, it seems to be well aligned with that.
Great talk. You stole my question, but I have another one. And apologize because I wasn't sure exactly, but it seems there was a lot of similarities between reinforcement learning and some of the stuff you were talking about. What is the exact difference at the end when you were talking about the policy? And is it in a reward function that you define a cost function, or
it is? You can think of it as a reinforcement learning problem, okay. Or you can also think of it, but it's kind of like a model based, I would think, reinforcement learning problem, where we have a model of the world. And we have uncertainty associated with it. So the model kind of has a sense, the algorithm has a sense of what it knows or what it doesn't know, and it tries to collect data to optimize some objective function. So it's very related to active learning and reinforcement learning. You can think of it that way. It's very, very related.
Can I ask one more? Going back to the latent variable, I'm assuming not all the time there, or are you trying to always define latent variables such that it's human understandable?
That's a great question. So interpretability is a big problem. Like not sometimes it does,
right.
and we don't really understand why it happens. And so some of these variables are meaningful, some of them are not. And so it's a big research question how to force the model to find more meaningful representations and also how to find them in a disentangled way so that, because you could imagine many different ways of describing the object, some of them the axes are sort of like aligned with what we think is a reasonable way of describing an object, and some of them they are not. And there is a priori no good reason for why the model should find one that is aligned with what we think is a reasonable way of describing an object. So there's a lot of research going on in trying to figure out ways to encourage the model to find more disentangled representations.